Hello, my name is David Faure and I work for KDAB. In this video, I would like to show you how to implement an actual communication protocol between a client and a server using JSON to communicate over a socket. We will use asynchronous APIs to avoid blocking the user interface, as I showed in part 2 of this series, which you can refer to if you haven't seen it yet. Let's start with a little demo. Our client application has evolved a little bit. Now, when we run a query, we get the results from the server, which has looked into the database. And you can see here that the full contents of the database are not that many. But this is what we are going to use to be able to make queries. For instance, if I say, let's have a look at everyone who lives in New York, then I can, if I type New York, and then it's going to filter on these. And if I look for anyone living in the nice city of Nice, nobody, as expected, right? So this is how it works, and we can choose on which field we are going to make the query. All right, let's have a look at the communication protocol between the client and the server. The client issues a command called getMatches, and it will pass along the criteria for the filtering and the actual string typed by the user, and the server will perform the database query and return the results. Those results include name and city and country, but it does not include the flag for the country. So the client will make another request to ask, please give me the flag for France, give me the flag for the US, and so on. This example was just to have a way to have multiple queries to the server, one after the other, and we need all of that to fill in the GUI. All right, so what does that look like in the code? When we click on the button to say, I would like to query after filling the criteria, like New York, for instance, it will go to the connection class and prepare the query. This is where we are going to use the JSON classes that are part of QtCore. What we can use a QtJSON object. This is like a map, so key and value. And we are going to fill the map with the name of the command, getMatches, and then the parameters for that command. So the name of the field and the string, the search value. That is our JSON request. We have to send it to the server, and we do that with the send command method, which simply serializes that JSON object. We first have to put it into a JSON document. That's the thing we can serialize. It's the complete JSON document. And we turn that into a string. And I'm using the compact formatting so that it all fits on a single line. This makes things easier on the server side because we can, as we did before, we can simply react to a full line to know that the request is complete. So here we simply write the JSON request in a single line and flush the request so that it gets sent to the server. Okay, let's have a look at the server now. In the client handler that we saw before, the slot ready read is now a little bit more complete. Once we have a full line, we are going to parse it as JSON using QJSON document from JSON, and this gives us the document. We know that this document is expected to contain a map or a JSON object, so that's what we get out of it, and we can ask for the command field to see what type of command it is. And we can right away handle the quit command, which will simply quit the application. Now, if not, then it might be either the getMatches or the getFlagName command. We prepare a response, which is another JSON object. We do the query in the database with the parameters of the command, and then we have a result, which is in this case, it's a vector of persons, right? That's what we have here. And what we do with this vector is serialize it to JSON. So the way I do it here is using the transform algorithm to iterate over the vector. And for every person in there, we are going to call the toJSON value, which again creates a JSON object, fills the four fields in it, first name, last name, city, and country. And that's what gets returned here. And that's what we put into so we insert it into the array of, so it's a JSON array, it's an array of objects. And once we have that, we insert that array into the response under the key matches and write the response back, which is basically the same code as in the client, we serialize into a single line and send it over. If we are being asked for the flag name, it's basically the same. Extract the country parameter, do the query from the database, and then write the result back. Okay, so this way we can have, we can use JSON as a way to encode requests and also responses. And once we have sent the response, we can come back to the client code. And in the client, the response arrives onto the socket, so it will call the slot ready read. And now we can see one of the not so nice things about asynchronous code. That same slot ready read is being called for the responses for all sorts of requests. So the first thing we have to do is to figure out for which command is this a response. So what I did here is to simply copy the name of the command into the response so that we know what this is. And we can dispatch based on the name. Is it get matches? Is it get flag name? And then call different methods depending on which one it is. So let's say it was matches, the first one. We go to this this method here, which will get the array of responses and fill the GUI with it. Okay, this part is not the the problem. We simply iterate, create a vector of persons by deserializing, as we do here, and then we emit that for the GUI to fill the list widget. But what about the countries? We have to figure out which country names are being used in there. And we do that with the list of countries here, country names, which is a string list. And now the problem is we want to query the flags for these countries, but we can't simply do that with a for loop or a while loop because that would be blocking code. To do this with non-blocking code, we will have to do them one at a time. So we are going to go to this query next country method, which will get the first one out of the list, send the query for it, wait for the response, and only once the response comes in, then we will ask for the next one. So that's what asynchronous code looks like. We have to do it one at a time and come back to the event loop and do it later. We can't just write a loop around it. And that's what you can see when we process flag name response in this code here. To figure out which country we were asking for, we'll reuse the list of pending countries again, take the first one, get the flag from the response, and there we have it. This is the name of the flag for this country. We can emit the signal and then query the next country so that we, step by step, we get through all of them as needed. So it works, but it is not very easy to write code because we have to remember to do everything one step at a time and have some sort of state like the pending country names that we can query for what is it that I'm getting a response for and then what do I need to do next. All right, the example here shows all of this based on local sockets, but obviously if we were doing this over the network, we would use the classes QTCP socket and QTCP server instead of QLocal socket, QLocal server, and everything else here would be the same. In the next video, I will show you how to write blocking code, because that is actually easier, but we can't do that in the main thread of a GUI application, so we'll do that in a secondary thread. If you have any questions about this code, don't hesitate to leave a comment under the video, and I'll be happy to answer it for you. Cheers, bye-bye.